All right, so how on earth does a country actually get a handle on its own currency? Today, we're going to dive into the fascinating story of Israel, which was basically a real-world economic laboratory. They were on a quest to tame inflation and build a modern, stable economy. And let me tell you, it's a story of trial and error and some seriously clever thinking.
And that brings us to the core puzzle of this whole thing. See, Israel started out with what's called a fixed exchange rate. They basically pegged the shekel to the US dollar, which leads to a really interesting question. How can something that's supposed to be fixed and stable end up being so incredibly unstable?
Okay, so let's really get into this dilemma. On paper, a fixed rate sounds amazing, right? It gives businesses predictability, it helps keep prices in check. What's not to love? But in the real world, especially for an economy like Israel's back in the 1980s, well, it turned into a massive headache.
And it created this brutal downward spiral. First up, you've got crazy high inflation just chewing away at the shekel's real value. So your money is worth less and less day by day. Second, to defend this supposedly fixed rate, the central bank had to constantly sell off its emergency stash of foreign money. We're talking US dollars. And those reserves started getting terrifyingly low. And when that happens, boom, you hit the final step. Nobody believes in the system anymore. Credibility is just gone.
So what do you do? Well, the government's only real tool was something called devaluation. It's just a fancy way of saying they'd officially announce, hey everyone, your money is now worth less than it was yesterday. And, you know, when you have to do that again and again and again, people start to think, wait a minute, this doesn't feel very fixed to me. It feels like a promise that just keeps getting broken.
So clearly, that wasn't working. The trust was gone, and they had to do something different. But the answer wasn't just to throw their hands up and let the currency go wild. No, they needed to build in some flexibility. And this is where we see the first really big, clever idea pop up, the flotation band.
The easiest way to picture this is like a highway with guardrails. The central bank created this corridor for the currency's value. As long as the shekel stayed within that corridor, let's say plus or minus 3%, the market could do its thing, letting the price bounce around. But if it ever crashed into one of those guardrails, that's when the central bank would jump in. It was this really neat middle ground. Not totally rigid, but not a total free-for-all either.
But, of course, that created a whole new problem. It was a great idea, but the band was flat. It was static. Just think about it for a second. What happens when your local inflation is roaring along at 10% a year, but your currency corridor is only 3% wide? You're still falling behind, right? The pressure just builds and builds. That little highway just wasn't wide enough.
So the economists went back to the drawing board, and they came up with something even more brilliant. They thought, okay, a flat highway isn't working, so what if we put the entire highway on an escalator that's always moving up? And that, right there, is how the Diagonal Flotation Band was born. And this was seriously a pioneering idea in economics.
Here's the genius part. Instead of a flat band, they literally tilted the entire corridor upwards. Both the upper and lower limits, the guardrails, were now designed to creep up at a steady, predictable pace. And that pace was set to basically match the expected inflation. In essence, they built a slow, steady depreciation right into the system itself. It was automatic.
And that's really the key thing to remember. This diagonal band was the best of both worlds. You got the predictability of the old system because everyone knew the path that escalator was taking, but you also got the flexibility you needed to handle inflation without constantly blowing things up. It was this incredible way to manage what people expected and what was actually happening in the economy.
Now, it's important to remember all this stuff, these clever bands and corridors, this wasn't just guesswork. This was all grounded in some pretty solid economic theory. So let's just take a quick step back and look at the big picture. The classic debate between a fixed currency rate and a floating one.
This chart pretty much boils down a library's worth of economic textbooks. The basic idea is this. A fixed rate is actually pretty good for handling problems that start inside your own country. You can think of these as internal shocks. But a floating rate, one that can move around freely, is way, way better for handling external shocks. You know, all the curveballs the rest of the world throws at you.
So what are we talking about with external shocks? Well, things like the U.S. Federal Reserve suddenly jacking up interest rates, or a big global recession, or a massive spike in oil prices. These are things a country has zero control over. With a floating currency, the currency itself acts like a shock absorber. It gets weaker or stronger to cushion the blow. But if your rate is fixed, all that pressure lands right on your central bank.
So when you put it all together, you start to see the whole picture.
For decades, Israel was like this living, breathing, economic laboratory. They weren't afraid to try something, see it fail, learn from it, and then try something new and better. They were evolving their entire economic system in real time.
And this timeline really lays out the whole saga, doesn't it? You start with the total crisis of the fixed rate in the 80s. Then, in 89, they take that first step towards flexibility with the horizontal bands. That gets upgraded to the super smart diagonal bands throughout the 90s. And then finally, by 2005, the economy was strong enough, stable enough, that the training wheels could come off entirely, and they moved to a fully floating system.
And what was the payoff for all this experimentation? Well, it was huge. The central bank got more independence, the economy got way better at handling those global shocks we talked about, a real modern foreign exchange market developed, and at the end of the day, they finally got the one thing they were chasing all along, stable prices.
And if you want a story that shows just how massive this transformation was, get this. Back in 1976, the Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin was forced to resign. Why? Because he and his wife had a simple bank account with a few thousand US dollars in it. It was illegal. Just think about that. Today, having an account in a foreign currency is completely normal. It's a routine financial activity. That one little story shows you the night and day difference between the old controlled economy and the open one they built.
So that brings us to the big question at the end of all this. There's no doubt that this journey, from a brittle, crisis-prone system to a flexible, resilient one, was a massive success. But the thing about economics is, the lab is never really closed. The experiment never truly ends. So, have they finally found the perfect formula? Or is this just the latest, most successful phase in a story that's still being written?